एम सी एस अबोली पित्रे एंड वेलकम टू सिक्स लेक्चर ऑफ अवर लेक्चर सीरीज ऑन कंपनी लॉ. टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस थ्री इंपॉर्टेंट डॉक्ट्रिन्स विच आर डायरेक्टली रिलेटेड टू अवर प्रीवियस वीडियो ऑफ मेमोरेंडम एंड आर्टिकल्स ऑफ एसोसिएशन. सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विद अवर फर्स्ट डॉक्ट्रिन, दैट इज डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ अल्ट्रा वायरस. द वर्ड्स अल्ट्रा वायरस लिटरली मीन्स बियॉन्ड पावर. When we were studying the object clause of Memorandum of Association, we discussed that company has to perform within the limits set by object clause of the memorandum. Any act done beyond the limits specified by memorandum is considered to be void, as it is ultra vires, that is beyond the powers of company, something that company cannot do and therefore do not have any legal effect. The same is explained by the doctrine of ultra vires. It simply states that anything which is done beyond the limits given in MOA is considered as ultra vires and hence is void and does not have any effect in the eyes of law. Let's see this with the help of a case law. The name of the case is Ashbury Railway Carriage and Iron Company Limited versus Rich. In this case, Ashbury Railway Carriage Company had entered into a contract with Mr. Rich for financing the railway line in Belgium. However, when the time came to actually perform the contract, the company repudiated the contract and said that this contract and even the act of entering in this contract is ultra vires to our memorandum. And therefore, this contract cannot be given any effect to, and therefore, we are not bound to perform the contract. Their contention was, as per our memorandum of association, our business is specified. And what business we can do is make or sell or lend on hire the railway carriage or wagons. And it also gave the permission to do business of mechanical engineers and general contractors. So the business of the company was limited to these points only. It nowhere mentioned performing the financing activity. Providing finance for some project is a completely different business activity from actually performing that project. And therefore, they were saying that it is ultra vires and therefore this contract does not have any effect in the eyes of law. However, Mr. Rich disagreed and they challenged this contention of the company in the court of law, and they said the memorandum of association uses the words general contractors. Now this use of word general contractors enables the company to act like any other general contractor, and general contractors do provide the services of financing a project, and therefore this act of company of entering into contract to finance the railway line is well within their memorandum of association. It is not ultra vires and therefore they are bound to perform the contract. Now let's see what House of Lords held in this case. When giving the judgment about this case, House of Lords held that any object clause of memorandum of association has twofold objective. First is to define clearly and unambiguously the ambit and extent of powers of the company, and secondly to ensure that nothing is done beyond these limits given. Okay, so these are the two objectives of any memorandum of association. And after considering this, we have to read the memorandum, right? So when we read the word general contractors in this MOA, we have to make sure that no meaning is given to it which is in contravention to the objective. It cannot be interpreted as if company is authorized to do any general contracts. It should be interpreted in line with the main objective. So it should be interpreted as to enter into any other general contracts which are ancillary and necessary to perform the main objective of making and selling the railway carriage or wagons, etc. And therefore, House of Lords held that this act of company of entering into contract to finance some project is ultra vires. Also, House of Lords explained that even if such act is ratified, that is agreed to by the shareholders of the company, still it remains ultra vires because something that company cannot do as per law cannot be ratified and made good by shareholders by ratifying the same. These are some of the consequences of any act that the company has performed ultra vires. So first is injunction. The suit of injunction is filed when a party who is filing for an injunction wants to stop someone from performing certain act. So here the members of the company can go ahead and file for injunction for any act that directors are committing beyond the powers of the company. The second consequence is the personal liability of directors. The capital of the company which is raised from public is to be used only for the objective which is mentioned in the object clause. And if the directors of the company use that money for anything else, it becomes an ultra vires act, and in that case it is a personal liability of directors to repay that money which they have used ultra vires to the objective of the company. They have to pay it from their own pockets back to company. The next is breach of warranty. When the directors of the company are promising something, giving warranty of something to third party while entering into the contract, however, this warranty given is ultra vires to the object of the company, in such case the other party to whom such warranty is given can file for breach of warranty against the directors. The next consequence is related to ultra vires acquired property. Now what if the company does not have authority to buy and acquire certain property as per the object clause, however it still went ahead and acquired some property? In that case, however, the property still remains to be the property of company. That contract is held as a legally valid contract. It is an exception to all other things that we have discussed till now. The next is related to contract, which is ultra vires. Obviously, any contract that the company has entered into which is ultra vires to their powers is void and it cannot be given any effect to in the eyes of law. The next doctrine to be understood is doctrine of constructive notice. When any company is incorporated, memorandum and articles of association of company are registered with registrar of company. The office of registrar is a public office, which means any documents of any company which are registered with it are easily available to public for inspection. Even people can take copies of it. Section 399 of Companies Act 2013 gives us right of inspection, which means any person can go to ROC and for payment of nominal fees can get access to the documents which are registered with ROC. This is important because the doctrine of constructive notice says any person who has entered into any contract with company is presumed to have read the memorandum and articles of association of the company, and after reading them he has entered into the contract after making himself well aware about the position of the company as per MOA and AOA. This is the doctrine of constructive notice. This presumption that the person has read the document can be said to be the constructive notice given to that person. The word constructive in law is generally used to say deemed notice. Like we also use this word for constructive possession, means deemed possession. Similarly, here this presumption that person must have read the MOA and AOA because it is easily available at ROC, and after reading those documents only he has agreed to be in contractual relationship with the company. This presumption is called as constructive notice. Now, why this presumption is made? Because tomorrow the person cannot claim of not knowing something which is already made public by MOA and AOA of the company. Therefore, the person cannot take defense that I was not aware of something while entering into contract with company. This doctrine protects the company from outsider from claiming that he did not know about something which the company has already made public by way of MOA and AOA. Now let's see a small case about it. The name of the case is Kotla Venkata Swami versus Chinta Ramamurthy. In this case, there was a company, and in the articles of association of a company, it was specifically mentioned that when a company is entering into contract with any party, on behalf of company, it must be signed by three people. Who are those three people? Managing director, secretary, and working directors. Unless and until these all people have signed, this contract cannot be considered to be signed by company. Now, the company entered into the contract with Chinta Ramamurthy, and when this contract was entered into, only secretary and working director signed and managing director's signature was missing from the contract. And still, Chinta Ramamurthy agreed to this inadequately signed contract, and he did not take care of ensuring that even managing director's signature is there. Now, when at the time of actual performance of the contract, the company repudiated the contract and said this contract is not valid because it is inadequately signed, and therefore we cannot consider that we as a company have signed this contract because managing director's signature is not there, which is required as per articles of association, and therefore we are not bound by this contract. At that time, this Chinta Ramamurthy said that no, I am an outsider. How am I supposed to know who all people are supposed to sign on behalf of company? And I saw the signature of secretary and working director. I thought it is adequate enough, and therefore I gave effect to this contract, and therefore the company is bound by this contract because he acted in good faith. However, the court held no. This contention of Chinta Ramamurthy is not valid because of the doctrine of constructive notice. It is assumed, Mr. Chinta Ramamurthy, that when you entered into the contract with this company, you have read the articles of association. The articles of association specifically mentions that the signature of these three people are required, and still you agreed to accept this inadequately signed contract, and therefore this cannot be considered as a valid defense. It was negligence from your part which cannot be helped with, and therefore this contract is not bound on company by applying the doctrine of constructive notice. The doctrine of constructive notice, however, is not limited to memorandum and articles of association. It even goes beyond and is extended to all the documents which are filed with ROC. Because not only MOA and AOA, multiple documents during the course of business of company are filed with Registrar of Companies. For example, charges that the company has under Section 77, it is mandatory for company to file with Registrar of Companies, or even some special resolution that company has passed must be filed with ROC under Section 117. Also, some agreements, if any, the company has entered into must be filed with ROC. So these all things are also available with Registrar of Companies. Therefore, it is also assumed that any person who is willing to enter into contract with company has read all those documents which are available with Registrar of Companies regarding the company he intends to enter into contract with, and then only he has agreed to sign that contract. Exactly opposite to the doctrine of constructive notice is the doctrine of indoor management. Now, this doctrine of indoor management protects the outsiders against the company. What doctrine of constructive notice was doing? It was protecting the company against the negligence of outsiders. However, here the outsiders are protected by this doctrine. Now understand it carefully that constructive notice doctrine is applicable only to external position of company. Means whatever is mentioned in articles of association or memorandum of association or any other documents which are filed with ROC, only these things are supposed to be known by the outsiders, right? Outsiders is not required to know how the internal machinery and internal relationships between the officers of the company work. And therefore, if there is any irregularity between this internal machinery of company, and because of that, some outsider is getting affected, then this doctrine of indoor management protects the interest of outsider. As long as the outsider person who is entering into contract with company has taken all the precautions and his actions are consistent with the doctrine of constructive notice, that he has read all the documents and then he is performing the contract with company, at that time any irregularities in the internal machinery of the company should not harm the outsider's interest. That care is taken by the doctrine of indoor management. Let us understand this doctrine further with the help of a case law. The name of the case is Royal British Bank versus Turquan. In this case, the directors of a company had borrowed some funds from the plaintiff, that is Royal British Bank. And in the articles of association of that company, the power to borrow funds was given to directors. However, this power to borrow the funds was conditional that the directors might borrow such sum as may be authorized by shareholders at general meeting. So the shareholders of the company will from time to time authorize the directors to borrow funds for company. Therefore, when Royal British Bank, before entering into contract with the company to give them funds on loan, read these articles of association, they did come to know that directors do have authority to borrow funds. However, this authority is conditional to the shareholders' resolution. But this matter of taking the permission of shareholders is internal affair of the company. It is to be taken care of by the company and it has nothing to do with outsider. Therefore, Royal British Bank assumed that directors are borrowing funds from us. It means they are being authorized by the shareholders and therefore they gave the loan to the directors of the company. What happened is, later the shareholders of the company claimed that directors had no such power because we never passed a resolution giving such borrowing powers to these directors. And therefore they said that this contract, this is not valid because directors, they did not have this power as such. Then this plaintiff's money was stuck, right? So they went into the court of law and claimed that how are we supposed to know that this directors did not have power from the shareholders? It is the internal affair of the company. The court upheld their contention. Court held, by applying the doctrine of indoor management, they come to the conclusion that it is a matter of irregularity between internal machinery of this company. Directors should have taken the care of getting this shareholders resolution passed, and therefore this irregularity should not affect the interest of an outsider, and therefore this transaction of borrowing money was considered to be a valid transaction. These are the circumstances when the outsider cannot take the defense of doctrine of indoor management. What are these circumstances? First, when the outsider had the knowledge of irregularity and still he went ahead and entered into the contract. The second exception is forgery. In case of forgery, the consent of anybody from company is absent, and therefore the contract cannot be given effect to, and therefore it is an exception. The next exception is negligence. Negligence from the side of outside party. When the outside party is at such a position that after doing basic research, they would have come to know about this irregularity, and still they did not do so, they did not take proper care and went ahead and entered into the contract, at that time we cannot say that doctrine of indoor management shall be applied. The next is act outside apparent authority. Sometimes, you know, it is very obvious. For example, tomorrow if I want to buy some property of company, which is, for example, I want to buy a piece of land which is in the name of bank, and accountant of the company is signing the contract on behalf of bank, at that time it is obvious that no accountant shall have authority to sell the asset of the bank, right? He's just an employee. At that time it is very obvious, and in such case this act is outside the apparent authority of accountant, and therefore I cannot say that I did not know whether he has the authority or not. It is obvious that he does not have the authority. In that case, the doctrine of indoor management cannot be applied. So these are the exceptions to this doctrine. I hope these three doctrines are clear to you. If yes, then don't forget to like this video, leave your comments down below, and subscribe to my channel. I will see you in next video. Till then, take care. Goodbye.